I think one thing I noticed over the past couple of years is a real trend in terms of the standards of the hardcore wrestling fans being decreased significantly. And TLC 2015 to me was an example of that. Now, a lot of people were like me and they thought the show was bad and they thought it sucked. But you had that segment that actually tried to pass it off as at least being passable. Or even, dare I say, being good or really good. And I just sit there and say to myself, wow, have we gotten that far? That's the environment that the WWE has cultivated today, is that they've done such a successful job of lowering the bar so much that even if we get a little bit of something we maybe like, or maybe just a little bit of something we could sink our teeth into, we overreact and think this is great and this is awesome, when we should know deep down in our minds that it's still crap. And TLC was crap, period. Now, of course, another example to me of just how much our standards have lowered as wrestling fans over the past few years, because frankly, who could blame you? Because if you kept your standards where they were in the past, there's no reason you would watch any North American professional wrestling company. WWE, TNA, Ring of Honor, doesn't matter. Why would you watch any of them? Even compared to what they were 5, 6, 7 years ago, all of those companies suck and suck very badly. And I think everybody acknowledges this and owns this to be true. But I look at Raw and I see the reactions to it this week. And people are pumping this up like this is some great, magnificent show. And of course, the WWE got a temporary rating spike out of it. So they're going to think that this was great and this was awesome. And again, I just sit there and I say, you know, man, how low have our standards gotten that that shit passes off as really good, great, mark out throughout the night, fucking worthy. Now, contrary to what some of you believe, I don't come on here just to sit there and play counterpoint to every fucking buddy else. Because I frankly could care less. Because at the end of the day, I really don't pay attention to much else that anybody else really truly says in terms of other people that come on here and do reviews or they blog about it or write about it for the Chop Shop Dirt Sheets, whatever the case might be. I couldn't give a fuck. Frankly, a lot of those other people are morons any goddamn ways. So at least you should know, if anything else, when you tune in and to a video on this channel for whatever reason that you do, and sometimes I wonder why you do, at least you should know that you feel like you're getting the genuine thing, that I actually at least legitimately believe it, and that I'm not bullshitting you, and I'm not trying to bullshit myself. If anything, I'm trying to bullshit myself and to still continue to find reasons to watch and support the product, if anything. But you should feel like, at least if anything else, you're getting the genuine article when it comes to me. Now, I will say this, is that this week's Raw was so much better than anything that this company's put out on Monday night over the past several months. Point blank, period. This show had a little bit of a different feel to it. There was enough to latch onto. You had certain people in the perfect positions and the perfect roles. And it left you with a little bit of a feeling of spontaneity, of you didn't really know what was going to happen and you wanted to see what would happen next. And if that's what this company set out to do with this show, then it was mission accomplished, and they did a relatively good job of that. Still, though, for 3 hours, there's a lot of filler. There's a lot of pointless crap. A lot of thrown-together tag matches, a lot of matches that we don't freaking need. You know, this three-hour shit every week has killed it for a long period of time. I can't believe there used to be knuckleheads that thought three-hour Raws would be a good idea because it would give more young guys a chance to shine. Shows how stupid they were. This is still not a great show, but I could at least sit there and anything else and actually justify why I spent 3 hours watching it this week. And that was something. That doesn't lead to me taking that next big monumental leap and saying this was really, really, really damn good or anything like that. I mean, don't be ridiculous, because it wasn't. But it was better. Now, I'll take better at this point. For example, one example of better, and a perfect example of better, is Stephanie McMahon. The only Stephanie McMahon on TV that works is Bitch Steph. Because Bitch Steph is believable. And she's so much better at Bitch Steph. When her and Triple H, over the past couple of years at different times, have been trying to vacillate between being the bad guys and being the good guys and trying to get themselves over at any expense, it doesn't matter how they got themselves over or why they got themselves over. Now you send her out there, she's pissed about what happened to her husband at the hands of Roman Reigns. It ties right into what happened at the pay-per-view. She's mad. She's ornery. She's PMSy. She's Bitch Steph. And bitch Steph is always the best Steph, period. This is where she shines. One of the most realistic feeling characters in the WWE, because in a lot of ways you feel that bitch Steph is real Steph off the camera, in spite of the public face that you might put on. So there's a genuineness there. There is a believability factor there. And you would think, again, that she would be pissed about somebody doing that to her husband, even knowing damn good and well, it's kind of that ratchet mentality of, my man didn't do nothing, even though he fucking did do something, and that's why somebody's trying to come after him. Well, in this case, you know Triple H has been fucking with Roman for a while, and lo and behold, Roman explodes. He's pissed off because he knows Triple H is out there to rub salt in the wound. So, of course, Stephanie, being bitch Steph, doing what bitch Steph should do, she's pissed off about it, and she's repeatedly slapping the shit out of Roman Reigns, laying down the gauntlet that her daddy is going to come save the day later. Perfect. Magnificent segment. Magnificent segment. This was incredible. Now, you get other crap, like right after that, you put Dolph Ziggler in the second segment of the night, because that's where that bitch ultimately deserves to be at this point. So, frankly, why would you invest anything more into him? Both from the company standpoint and, frankly, from a fan standpoint, too. The epitome of a guy that just kind of seems to be going with the flow and going with the motions. And honestly, who could fucking blame him? Who could blame him? And again, it's just, a guy that you've invested at different times a certain amount into, you just waste him as a plot device for what's going on between Dean Ambrose and Kevin Owens. Now, at least I will say this, they had Kevin Owens come out with no theme music. So it felt more real. And that's a common thread throughout this show, is that it had a different presentation to it. It had a little bit of a different feel to it at times. Just enough to get me by. It was like, ooh. I had that a couple of times. And I miss having that feeling. It doesn't have to happen all throughout the show. But a couple of times, it's nice to have that. Be like, ooh, that was well done. Or, ooh, that's a good touch. Or, ooh, I like how they did that. Kevin Owens coming out storming to the ring in the middle of the Ambrose-Ziggler match. Without his theme music hitting, him just coming out and immediately laying waste, magnificent. It's fucking good. It feels like how it should feel if a villain lost his fucking title the previous night. No pre-choreographed outcoming to the ring music bullshit. He's just storming down when the fuck he wants to, and he's laying out Ambrose and he's laying out Ziggler. Well done indeed. And then you've got this Extreme Rules tag match. And yes, while it pisses me off that so often WWE does this now, they'll expect you in some capacity to pay for the match on pay-per-view or on the WWE Network. But then the next night, they'll basically give you the same damn match all over again. And that's what they did with the Wyatt Family versus the ECW Originals. But I sit there, and they've got that little segment beforehand where you've got Bubba, you've got D-Von, you've got Tommy Dreamer, you've got Rhino. You know, it felt like a good ripoff of a late 90s ECW Paul Heyman-produced promo. It had those elements there. And what the hell, a New Jack appearance in the clips. I hope you got your royalties for that, brother. FTW. FTW indeed. But I look at those four guys, and they looked like professional wrestlers, and they felt like professional wrestlers, and frankly, they acted like professional wrestlers. And again, there was a genuineness there. There was a believability there. And I didn't even care so much about the match because I had a feeling the way that was going to go. But you know, you're in Philly, so you're giving a little nod off to the company that fucking RIP died 14 and a half fucking years ago. So that way people could circle jerk to it, whatever. Philly could be feeling good about themselves again. But really, more importantly, it just, to me, when I saw that, I'm like, you know, these guys used to be mid-carders and under-carders when this shit was really good. And even today, they look just as much, if not more, like a professional wrestler than anybody on the freaking damn main roster. They act like it. They conduct themselves as such. They talk as if. I mean, well done. And I love the way it was pieced together. I love the visuals of it. And that stuff matters to me. Maybe it doesn't matter to some of you as much, but that's the kind of stuff sometimes that I like more than the flips and the kicks and the whoop-de-woo. Oh my God! He did a flaming anal gator 900 into a freaking barbed wire table on fire of glass! Something like this, a little two-minute promo vignette with these four guys. You got Dreamer up on the ladder, Rhino behind the cage. You know what it really felt like? It felt like one of those awesome classic Survivor Series promos from back in the day almost, without all the craziness and scary sharing climbing all over the fucking and all types of chaos and pandemonium. That was good. And then the Extreme Rules tag match, you know, I actually had more fun watching that than I did the pay-per-view match on Sunday night. Good for television. Yes, basically a repeat of what you had in a lot of ways the night before, but I found myself actually enjoying it more than I did the pay-per-view match. But then we get to the thing that really matters, and that is Vincent Kennedy McMahon. And I've been wanting this guy to come back on TV for a long time because this product needed something. And at the end of the day, Vince McMahon is arguably the biggest star that that company has ever produced. Biggest. And I always maintain, because of his importance to the company at the time and everybody that ran through him and worked with him and that he made better, that Vince McMahon was a true star of the Attitude Era. People talk about that's the Austin era, it was Austin and Rock. Man, fuck you, it was Vince McMahon. It was Mr. McMahon that made that shit work. McMahon could work without Austin. Austin couldn't work the same without McMahon to feed off of. And that's a fact. The Rock could have still been The Rock to a degree, but he was better because he had Vince McMahon to work off of. But Vince McMahon could still be Vince McMahon. He could still be Mr. McMahon without having any of these fucking guys. And it's striking to me. So many of us now are so frustrated with this old man. And we're so pissed off at this old man for different things. And we're so angry at this old man for the way this product is. And we want to say all these things to him. And we come on social media. We come on YouTube. We do all this crap. We talk all this shit. And wouldn't you know, when that limousine drives through and they show it and out pops Vince McMahon, he instantly gets the best reaction of the fucking night. And it's classic Vince too. That's not some pre-choreographed shit. It's Vince McMahon. He's fucking coming down and he don't give a shit because he's the boss. He's got that broomstick up his ass, BMF walk going as much as he ever fucking had. Classic shit. Bo Dallas, R-Truth, he doesn't want to fucking be bothered for you. Get out of my ring! Stop the match! Get out of my ring! Get! Again, a genuineness there. A believability there. Because you actually feel like that's what Vince McMahon would really do. And that's always been the genius of the Mr. McMahon character, the Vince McMahon on TV character. Because that's what everybody envisions him to be in real life. And probably in a lot of ways he is. It's just in this case, on TV, you ramp up the volume just a little bit, but not that much. One of the most organically natural, genuine characters in the history of professional wrestling, in my opinion, the greatest heel both on screen and off screen in the history of the damn business. No offense to Gorgeous George or Classy Freddie Blassie or Roddy Piper or anybody damn else. You can't hold Vince McMahon's butt pubes. When you talk about longevity as a heel, the ability to this day, if Vince McMahon sat there and booked himself in the main event of WrestleMania 32, he could fucking do it. People would believe it. And people would still pay money to see him get his ass kicked. The ultimate measurement of a truly great heel. Because even when the crowd is happy for him and he's cheering for him, he can take him 2 minutes later and flip him just like fucking that, like nobody's damn business. And it's so striking to me as he's sitting there and he's in McMahon mode. I'm like, man, imagine if you let just a couple of your top characters do what you do, to have the creative license, to have the liberty, to basically you have a certain thing you want to touch on, but you've got free liberty, you've got free reign, you just fucking going. And you see that in Vince. He's the boss. Was Kevin Dunn going to say, Vince, we need to wrap this up here. We've got to show that Rosebush segment. You ain't saying that shit to Vince.
Vince is going to get Vince over the Vince way. And man, that shit is classic. When he's standing there in the ring with Roman Reigns, it's incredible. You look at Roman Reigns and you're like, okay, he's a look guy. But goddamn it, once you know 70-year-old Vince McMahon looks more and feels more like a real professional wrestler than Roman Reigns does. Or anybody else, any of these other fucking bums on this fucking roster today. And that's an unequivocal fact. You could take Dean Ambrose's comb over, Kevin Owens and his fat lumberjack sloppy ass, Miz's Seth Rollins, whatever the fuck, and the bastard love child of a fucking Test and Diesel and Roman Reigns with a suntan, I guess you would say. None of them match up to Vince McMahon in any way, shape, or form. You legitimately look at Vince McMahon and think that he could still go with Roman Reigns in the ring even at 70 years old. And in fact, if you were a betting man in a real fight, you'd also probably put your money on Vince McMahon as opposed to Roman Reigns. It speaks to the greatness of Vince McMahon as an on-screen character,
It speaks to the greatness of the past. It also speaks to some of the problems of the present. But think about this from a Roman Reigns standpoint. You're trying to get this guy over. And by God, at the end of the day, you're going to do everything you can to get this guy over. You're going to John Cena 2.0 his ass until kingdom fucking come. Who better to help in that than Vince K. McMahon? We already know what this is about. It's ultimately, at the end of the day, all about God's WrestleMania match. If you think it's about anything else than that, you're fucking fooling yourselves. I told you. I told you again on the TLC review, and I'm telling you now, and you know I'm right. Praise God! But really, when you hear Vince McMahon said, it's like standing in the ring with God Almighty, you believe it. Because you think that son of a bitch actually believes himself to be God. We know the truth. We know that Hunter is the real God. But Vince McMahon, when it comes to WWE, got a lot of godlike qualities. But now you're throwing Vince McMahon at Roman Reigns. Other people have Triple H and Stephanie come after him. Other people have this bad guy or that bad guy come after him or get involved with him. When you get to the point where Vince McMahon is getting involved, that typically means something. That's usually pretty serious. Sure, you'll bring up the Drew McIntyre and the Hornswoggle crap, but throughout the history, and even look at then, they were featuring Hornswoggle in such a way that they were pushing him more than 95% of the roster. When they initially dubbed Drew McIntyre as Vince's chosen one, everybody thought that he was going to be one of the faces of the company for the next fucking decade. There's a credibility there. There's a believability there that if Vince gets behind you, it means something. Or if Vince gets involved with you, that means you mean something. And when you see Roman Reigns standing in the ring with Vince McMahon, it instantly, to me, elevates the profile of Roman Reigns. He instantly gains credibility. Because now the top guy of top guys, the HNIC of all that you see in WWE, is now bothered enough to fucking be bothered with you, that means you did something. And I think you can sense the crowd realizing it and understanding it. And I think the audience as a whole kind of realizes it and understands it. You know, now the whole thing about going right back, we just had a match between Reigns and Sheamus the night before. Do we need the match again? And now it's for the title again. And now we've thrown in this randomly thrown in stipulation because Roman won't apologize that if he doesn't beat Sheamus, he's fucking fired. I mean, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense from a storyline standpoint. It just doesn't. It's typical Vince bullshit. Knee-jerk reflex reaction, throw shit against the wall, hope it sticks, and assume the people are too stupid to call you out for this crap. Or assume that the people that will call you out for this crap, like me, will feel good about having their voices heard, but at the end of the day, ultimately will accomplish nothing with what they said, and as a result, you could just ignore it, and some of the other mindless bang, 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 sheep will just go on continuing and loving you no matter what. We get to Roman Reigns versus Sheamus in the main event. I wasn't sure that they were actually going to go there. I was thought in a way that maybe they were just going to go where they would have Reigns lose and they would have Reigns be fired. But that maybe would have been kind of predictable. I mean, they actually went there. They went there and had Roman beat Sheamus for the title. You ended Raw with a new WWE World Heavyweight Champion. On the positive side, you know, when we talk so much about the predictability of the show, one of the biggest things about the predictability of the show is that when the world title is defended on Raw, it's not changing hands. Now that you've ended the show with the title changing hands, when people thought it probably was going to happen until the Royal Rumble or maybe even WrestleMania, now you've reminded them that anything can technically happen on WWE television. And when you have that going for you, it means something. And it gives people a reason to tune in and watch next week. Maybe they'll think Vince McMahon will be there. I don't think he's going to be a recurring thing. They're going to want to see now how Triple H and Stephanie are going to react to this. They're going to want to see how Roman Reigns is now that he's the champion and he's established as the champion. He didn't just lose it 5 minutes later. He's the champion closing out the show. He's going to be the champion opening the show next week. You've got a long time until the Royal Rumble. You know, you've got a lot of interesting things here at play, and they're setting themselves up really nicely for Roman Reigns and Triple H at WrestleMania. Or if they're going to really hot shot shit, then you might be setting yourselves up for Roman Reigns versus Triple H at the fucking Royal Rumble. Who the hell knows? At this point in time, that could be as soon as they're heading into that direction. That could be what they're doing. So from a positive standpoint, it was something that most people didn't see coming. It was a legit surprise. it was a fresher face, a newer face, getting a spotlight, getting an opportunity to shine. You got to see Vince come back and be Vince in all of his freaking glory. You know, there were good things about doing it. And to the knuckleheads on the TLC review trying to sit there, nobody talks more about the business aspects of the WWE than me. So don't ever think for a second that these things are lost on me. And when you try to go with me on that and you try to lecture me on that, you sound stupid. So just stop. I understand. Ratings bad. Shock and surprise. USA probably breathing down their neck just a little bit. WWE had to do something. And to their credit, they did do something. So I understand it. And I get it. And ultimately, in terms of a singular entity for one night, there's a lot of wasted time still and a lot of crap that I didn't care about. But there was enough for me to care about and enough for me to like that gave me some hope. It's foolish hope. And next week we'll probably go right back to sucking again. But it was okay. Raw was okay. I'm not going to sit here and praise it to Kingdom fucking Come like it was great because there was a lot of crap that wasn't. And I'm also not going to just shit on it just to shit on it because there were some things that I genuinely enjoyed this week. At the end of the day, though, what keeps me from saying this is a really good or great show is because I really don't agree with Roman Reigns winning the WWE World Heavyweight Championship in the manner that he did, in the way that he did, when he did, and why he did. And I'll be talking about that in my next video. For now, for those of you that enjoyed Raw this week, you'll notice a lot of the other stuff that I didn't enjoy, I didn't fucking talk about because I didn't want to waste my time talking about it. I tried to emphasize the positives mostly of what I liked about this show. And I'll save the negativity for another video. That'll be the next video talking about the stupidity of Roman Reigns winning the title on fucking Raw.